This is a well-worn chair. For the past 50 years, it's been warmed by the backsides of a string of ambitious and often impatient men. This is the traditional seat for the leader of Her Majesty's loyal opposition in Parliament House, Canberra. And it's also a frustrating place, especially for the politicians who've been pinned down here by the man who sat directly opposite for a total of 19 years. He was Australia's longest-serving Prime Minister, Sir Robert Gordon Menzies.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. It's still the same old story. Fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
There are very many people who are looking in tonight, because I'm told it's almost compulsory, this. It's not an ordinary decision, this is... something that doesn't happen very frequently for a man to go out of office under his own steam. I've gone out of office before today under somebody else's steam, but this time under my own.
When Sir Robert Menzies left the Canberra stage in 1966, he was more than our longest-serving Prime Minister. For half the population, he was the only Prime Minister they'd ever known. And when he spoke to us all for the last time as leader, in his usual indulgent manner, it seemed only right. He was, after all, the father figure of the modern generation of Australians, the man who had led us through the 50s and 60s, and somehow it had all turned out pretty well.
I think the very great contribution he made was to head a government which engendered the respect of all Australians. Whether you agreed with it or not, you respected it. Mm-hmm. And that went for the world. He made Australia better known throughout the world than it ever had been before, and respected.
Menzies was born in the small Victorian country town of Japarit, and he was a bright and ambitious boy from the word go. After a shining academic and legal career, and a spectacular rise in politics, Menzies was just into his 40s when he began challenging the leadership of the ailing Prime Minister Joe Lyons. He was accused of disloyalty, but in the midst of a bitter struggle, Lyons died. The new country party leader, Earl Page, fought to keep Menzies out of the Prime Minister's chair, but to no avail.
This task was begun by the administration under my late leader and friend, Mr. Lyons. And this new administration will spare neither time nor energy in pushing on with this great work.
After only 6 months at the shaky helm, Menzies had to announce the outbreak of war, and the nation for the time being was distracted from internal politics.
Fellow Australians, it is my melancholy duty to inform you that in consequence of a persistence by Germany in her invasion of Poland, Great Britain has declared war upon her, and that as a result, Australia is also at war.
Menzies took on the role of war leader with energy and oratory which seems far removed from the understated style of later years.
We can't be beaten except by ourselves. We can't be beaten except by disunity within our own ranks, by the occasional ugly act of treachery within our own ranks.
Menzies went overseas to support and be seen with the diggers. With his home movie camera, double-breasted suit and trilby hat, he made an incongruous figure in the 100-degree heat of the Middle East. But however good the film coverage of his visit, the real enemy was still waiting at home. On his return, he tried to appear above politics, but he was stalling the inevitable.
I come back to Australia with just one sick feeling in my heart, and that is that I must now come back to my own country and play politics. I think that it's a diabolical thing that anybody should have to come back and play politics, however cleanly, however friendlily, at a time like this.
While Menzies had been away, some had found Artie Fadden, the acting Prime Minister, easier to get along with. There were old wounds which hadn't healed. And in the murderous days which followed, Menzies was forced to resign and Fadden was elected leader. But the Fadden government, in turn, was quickly brought to its knees when its 1941 budget was rejected in the House. The collapse of the government made way for Labour and their forceful leader, John Curtin.
That all the advancing that will be done will be by Australians, for it is Australians that stand for the policy of advancing Australia.
Curtin's charismatic leadership, combined with the now total disarray of the opposition parties, gave Labour an easy victory in the 1943 elections.
Sheehan, Labour member, is 13,000 ahead of Conway.
Chastened by the defeat, Menzies made his masterstroke. At a now famous conference at Albury, the Liberal Party was born, and Menzies was both mother and midwife. But the strain of the war years literally killed John Curtin. It left Chifley with problems of economic reconstruction, and he was forced to extend wartime austerity measures.
I'll take no risk with either inflation or depression.
When the Labour leader tried to nationalise the banks, many people reacted strongly against it with a campaign of strident public meetings. Petrol rationing was another emotive issue, and with the war won 4 years earlier, people resented not being able to fill their tanks when they wanted to. By the 1949 election, Menzies managed to combine the issue of rationing with the public fear of growing international communism. His campaign slogan was simple: tip out the socialists and fill up the Bowsers. It worked, and Menzies and his new Liberal Party were swept into office. It was the beginning of a record term for an Australian Prime Minister, the beginning of the Menzies years. When Robert and Patty Menzies unpacked their suitcases here at the lodge, no one thought they'd be here for such an incredibly long time. Menzies would stay at the helm for 17 straight years, as long, in fact, as the combined offices of all the Labour Prime Ministers in our history. His first hectic 20 years in politics had taught him a lot about survival, and he was determined not to make the same mistakes again. He learnt to feel the pulse of the electorate, and any danger which came from inside his own ranks could be solved with the occasional cabinet reshuffle or the odd inspired appointment. When he first arrived here, he was simply another distinguished lodger. But as the years passed, he established an unchallenged, benevolent dictatorship. And by the end, he'd been here so long, they called it the Ming Dynasty. There was now a definite shift in the Menzies style. The emphasis had moved from simply gaining power to making sure he kept hold of it. He knew how easily a leader could be white-handed, so he learned to live even with old enemies like Country Party leader Earl Page.
At the time of the big split in the early 40s, it was Sir Earl Page that made possibly the most cutting remark ever about Menzies in the Parliament. Never had such a great military career been cut short by the outbreak of war, was Page's words about Menzies, and yet Menzies was a pragmatic enough and tough enough and professional enough to realise that he needed Page back in that 1949 ministry, and Page went into it with him.
The new government was quickly blooded in a tremendous struggle over the issue of communism. Menzies' proposals to outlaw the Communist Party were rejected at a referendum. But then he used the Petrov spy sensations to his advantage. And in the famous Labour Party split which followed, he gained a curious new ally which would help keep him in power for the next decade, the DLP.
Menzies reigned only because of the split, for the length of time that he did reign. But how successful would they have been had the DLP not existed and given them the preferences?
Was he ever privately thankful to you, for example, for that?
Oh, well, he has expressed his gratitude for the help that we've given him, particularly in the close election that Caldwell just lost.
In fact, that election after the 1961 credit squeeze was his only really nasty moment. The Menzies government scraped home then by just 32 votes.
In the inscrutable wisdom of Providence, I have a majority of one, only was the Speaker in the chair.
But for the rest of the time, he seemed to run the country with consummate ease. And as for the party, some said he was like a benevolent headmaster.
I could never call him a headmaster, but he loved to predominate, he loved to excel. And I think you can take it that was either good, or it might have been perhaps a failure. I never found him very difficult to handle. I always went my own way. I know that frequently he didn't like it and frequently reacted, but it didn't stop me at all. I enjoyed myself whilst he was there.
He was perhaps impatient of some of his colleagues who were, I'd have been impatient of, because they were silly goats. But he wasn't. And I don't know of any dirty, naughty boys that he got rid of.
Well, the names that are always used as Casey, for one, as a potential rival, Spender.
But Casey was in Parliament right up till, for a long, long time. Spender, I think he got rid of, Spender went to the High Court of Justice or something. And who else did he get rid of? I don't know.
As the years passed, Menzies seemed to run the country almost as if it were a hobby. He worshipped cricket and the Queen.
I did but see her passing by, and yet I love her till I die.
I think one of the outstanding points about Menzies, and possibly other people might have said this to you, that Menzies knew in the 50s and 60s that what he was required to do to govern Australia was to do nothing. That was the Menzies masterpiece.
By the mid-60s, the political masterpiece had become an institution, a sort of Australian Chairman Mao. His distinctive features had become part of our way of life and our nostalgia. But now it was time to go. His legacy, according to those other prime ministers, McEwen, McMahon and Gorton, was the creation of the party, the fostering of Canberra itself, his reign on the economy and his support for universities. Certainly, he abdicated when the country had never been richer or stronger. But sadly, all of his legacies were not so kind. Before he left, he'd committed Australia to conscription and to Vietnam. There were hard times ahead. Was January 1966, and the King was bidding his subjects and courtiers farewell.
Looking at the clock, I see that we've had 50 minutes on this business, and some of you might say, with great justification,
well, he ought to give us 50 minutes. He's given us mighty few press conferences. Anyhow, thank you and good luck to you.
You see, whether we like it or not, right at this moment, Australia is at war. It is no less a real war than if it were being waged in the streets of our own cities. Vietnam is a reality. It's too late to shrug and walk away from it. But it's not too late to decide the role our young men will undertake in Vietnam. Will we be known as a nation that makes its presence felt in Southeast Asia with a submachine gun? You will decide this in the coming election. You must make up your own mind.
Arthur Augustus Calwell, the last of the old-style Labour leaders, doing what he did so poorly, electioneering. The issue was Vietnam, or more accurately, Australia's involvement in the war. Prime Minister Holt had borrowed the phrase, all the way with LBJ, and seemed headed for his first election victory as leader. For Calwell, the issue was something of an emotional crusade, and he took the fight all over the country.
On a cold winter's night like this, on June 22nd, 1966, Arthur Calwell was deep in Conservative country. He came here to speak at the town hall in Mossman, a staunchly upper-class suburb of Sydney. And he had an unwelcome message. If Labor won the election, he said, he'd bring the conscripts back from Vietnam. Nevertheless, it was an orderly meeting with just a few Liberal hecklers. And when it was all over, Mr. Calwell came out here and got into his car. Contrary to usual fashion, he left the window wound up. The cold night probably saved his life. A few seconds later, a young man walked up to the car, pointed a sawn-off shotgun at Mr. Corwell's face and pulled the trigger.
For the first few moments, there was confusion about the extent of Corwell's injuries. The scene of the shooting gave little indication, but with the memory of John Kennedy's assassination just 3 years old, the impact was real enough. In the Royal North Shore Hospital, Corwell's astonishing good fortune was revealed. The only real wound was to the massive Corwell chin, so beloved of cartoonists. It was lacerated with glass fragments, but somehow he had escaped any further injury. The hospital was able to let him go the following afternoon, and the still-shaken opposition leader was driven directly to the airport. Less than 24 hours after that one amazingly ineffective shot, the Labour leader was at Essendon in Melbourne, a few marks on his face, the only evidence of his brush with death. The next morning, the usual list of minor matters set down for hearing at the North Sydney Police Courts had one spectacular interruption: the bail hearing on a charge of attempted murder. The whole thing was short and swift. After the minimum necessary legal formalities, the 20-year-old, whose shot had been heard around the nation, was whisked away. Peter Kokan pleaded guilty to attempted murder and was given a life sentence. He was released in 1977 after serving 10 years in various institutions.
I wanted to make myself feel real. Now, for anyone who hasn't experienced the kind of psychological confusion that I experienced for several years prior to the attack on Mr. Corwell, that may sound a bit peculiar, but my problem really was that I didn't feel like a real person. I felt like some kind of shadow or ghost or disembodied wraith wandering the streets. And the significant thing about an act like that, the shooting, to me, was that at one stroke it would prove my realness. After all, you have to be real to pull a trigger, to set in motion the whole process of the media and headlines and so on and so on.
The issue that so nearly cost Arthur Corwell his life turned out to be an electoral asset for his opponents. On a pro-Vietnam platform, Harold Holt won a record majority for the Liberal Country Party coalition, and the faithful, hard-working Lieutenant to Menzies could now take his place as the duly elected Prime Minister. Holt's hobby of skin diving was already well known to the public. They looked on his enthusiasm for the sport with some humour. The thought of their Prime Minister slipping into a wetsuit had a faintly whimsical air. But then again, why not? We all have our weekend relaxations. Why shouldn't the Prime Minister go spearfishing in the seas near his Portsea home?
Surely only in Australia could the Prime Minister, the leader of the nation, even go for a walk on a beach like this with just a couple of friends and no one else. In what other country could the chief executive stride into the surf, and fairly wild surf at that, and swim out to sea alone? One imagines that if the American president went swimming at a beach like this, there might be some security frogmen not too far away. But Harold Holt loved his freedom, and besides, he was an experienced swimmer. He was 59 years old, he looked fitter than average, and he knew these waters well. What could possibly go wrong?
The alarm was raised at 12:40, and within minutes a massive search operation was underway. The Prime Minister was missing, presumed drowned. All of Melbourne's police, Army, Navy and Air Force resources were thrown into the hunt. When the search was abandoned in the failing light late that afternoon, it was already obvious that continuing the exercise would be little more than a gesture. The search would continue for another 3 weeks, but no trace of Harold Holt's body was ever found. At the request of reporters, the Prime Minister's press secretary, Tony Eggleton, obtained a statement from Mrs. Winton Gillespie, a neighbour and friend of the Holt family, who'd been watching from the beach as the PM swam out and disappeared. The statement was read by an ABC television reporter.
He did swim for quite some time, it seemed to me, but I suppose it was only a couple of minutes, and seemed to be swimming with his head above water quite well. I suppose desperately trying, thinking at this stage that if he swam, he might catch a wave back. But then, after this boiling up, it all subsided, and there wasn't a sign. Alan and I went and stood on a rock, and I don't think Alan realized. But nobody could have done a thing. It was like a leaf being taken out. It was so quick and so final.
To many Australians, the character of Harold Holt was captured in this informal portrait painted by his friend, Victorian artist Clifton Pugh. This was the Portsea Prime Minister, relaxed, suntanned, proud of his physical fitness. Clifton Pugh was himself an expert skin diver and a frequent swimming companion of the Prime Minister's.
And he went down to the water. It was a fine day. It was right at the turn of the tide, and the water gets absolutely calm. It really is there.
Mm.
And I think, you know, as he's a man that's got a press reputation of being a great swimmer and loves the ladies, and at the same time, I believe there was a young bloke and his young girl there, and I think it was the story of the old bull and the young bull, is that, you know, off he goes, swimming in the water, and out he goes without his wetsuit on, because he just went in without it. And he had a few drinks, and you get puffed very quickly, and particularly you're not used to it. The young bloke had much more sense. He went a little way and came back. But this is where the tragedy occurred, is apparently right at that time the tide changed, and the water becomes an absolute mill race. And then all in that water is a lot of debris, which is ballast chucked out by the boats, lots of pieces of wood. And then there's this long kelp, can get up to 30 foot long, whipping about in the water.
Mm.
And I think with being a little bit exhausted, of suddenly overarm charging out where you're not used to it, you might have just got a bit exhausted, could have been hit on the head by a bit of debris, caught by a bit of kelp, and in that sort of water, and just get suddenly caught down, there was all holes there and rock caverns, and I think probably just got pulled under.
As the world's leaders assembled at St. Paul's Cathedral to attend the memorial service, the commentators were already reflecting on the dramatic changes that had overtaken the face of Australian politics. Arthur Calwell was now retired onto the back bench, replaced by the new wave of Labour men led by Gough Whitlam. Holt's death would upset the whole future of the Liberal Party, which had been so carefully planned by Menzies. The stately order of leadership would be thrown into turmoil, a series of coups and counter-coups and new leaders, until the Liberals could find a new strongman. It would be a new era for Australian governments, and the political climate would never be the same again.
You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh, the fundamental thing as time goes by. As time